يوم ولا حول اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم واتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك أنت المقدم أنت المؤخر وأنت على كل شيء قدير والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر للذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر إن the name of Allah سبحانه وتعالى the most compassionate the most merciful all praise and thanks are due to him and peace and blessings be upon his beloved prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم he who is guided by the will of Allah no one can misguide him and he who is misguided no one can guide him except Allah سبحانه وتعالى we do bear witness that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his messenger السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته today our tafsir session number 110 alhamdulillah by the ni'mah blessings and tawfiq guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now today we will be dealing with still chapter al-baqarah surah al-baqarah ayah 258 alam tara ila alladhi hajja ibrahim fi rabbih an ataahu Allah al-mulk إذ قال إبراهيم ربي الذي يحيي ويميت قال أنا أحيي وأميت قال إبراهيم فإن الله يأتي بالشمس من المشرق فأتي بها من المغرب فبهت الذي كفر والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين Now this ayah comes after ayat al-kursi and another two ayat if you remember ayat al-kursi One of the most, actually it's not one, it is the most important ayah in the Quran. We highlighted about the concept of Tawheed and the most important attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, لا إكراه في الدين. If you remember, قد تبين الرشد من الغي. Then, الله ولي الذين آمنوا يخرجهم من الضلال. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is focusing in the three ayat which preceded this ayah. About the importance of Tawheed, the importance of sovereignty, the importance of the priority should be just for Allah. Allah is the creator. Allah is the Khaliq. Allah is the only one who deserves to be worshipped. And he is the one who's in charge of helping us to bring from darkness into lightness. Now Allah is giving examples. Okay? We have example number one about Ibrahim alayhi salam. After that, if you have another ayah next time, inshallah, أو كالذي مر على قرية وهي خاوية على عرشها. This is another example. So, Al-Quran is full of examples and full of stories. But I need to highlight something. Now, because I'm noticing, mashallah, new faces. Quran is a book of guidance. This is the most important title, the biggest title. Quran contains historical events, fact. However, it's not a book of history. Quran contains scientific facts. However, it's not a book of science. okay? It's a book of what? Guidance, hidayah. Allah uses history, uses logic, mantiq, information, legislation. It contains a lot of legislations for humanity, not for Muslims. Allah designed, if I may put it this way, this final revelation in a way to suit humanity. إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا He is a prophet of all humanity. We have this book. When we look at this, it contains stories, it contains examples, it contains just to push someone, to convince someone to the guidance. Now, part of the things are the stories. Now, let's fix the most important points about stories. Third of the Quran stories. Third nearly. Can you imagine? And the Quran is the constitution of Muslims and human for humanity to accept that. So it gives you the importance of telling stories. Because by the way, telling stories is not something simple and easy. It's very dangerous. How many people they brainwash kids all over the world? How? Stories. Why? When some certain countries they want to change the mentality of the population, they insist to start in schools through many ways, including cartoons, you know, networking, broadcasting things and stories of the kids. Because you start from the early beginning. You fix what you want, خلاص, the job is done. Mission accomplished. No need to waste any time. They are ready. So why I'm saying that? Because sometimes, yeah, Sheikh, you know, we are bored from listening to stories. Give us something very solid. Habibi, when Allah decided to make third of the story, and we are talking about the stories of the Quran. We are not talking about false, empty myths. It's not a myth. مش خرافات وكذا. No, no, no. We are talking about real stories or amthila or examples okay, or parables. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned a story, number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قال فقصص القصص لعلهم يتفكرون. Tell the stories, narrate the stories so that they might reflect upon. Number one. And another ayah, لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي من الباب. Indeed, in their stories, there was lesson, a deep wisdom, a deep lesson for those who use their power of intellect. Those who do what they reflect upon. They activate their faculty of reasoning. This is important to know before we start the story of Ibrahim. Another important thing, those who attended with us from the very beginning, they know it, but let's just fix inside if we have a new mashallah guest. Jazakumullah khair. Thank you jami'an for coming. Now, stories in the Quran, unlike any other place of stories. Generally, human beings, they use stories for entertainment. They use stories to, let's say, to make it simple to convey the messages. However, people, they love in the stories to add a lot of details, needed and not needed, extra, important and not important. This is the nature of a human being. And sometimes they exaggerate, and sometimes they lie, sometimes they fabricate. Sometimes, but what I'm concerned now, we as human beings, when we tell stories, we tend to go into details. And we mention whatever comes to our mind. And we love to know the details. This is not the nature of the Quran. Allah, Hasha Subhanahu Al-Hakim, does not tell except what is beneficial. But why I'm telling that? Because now, not knowing this will push a lot of people to waste their time in looking for some details which is not necessary. Got my point? Yeah, for example, in Surah Yusuf, chapter Yusuf. قَالَ يَا أَبَتِ إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحْدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا. Now we know the dream was about his brothers. Immediately. What is the name of his direct brother and their brothers? We don't know. Is it Benjamin? We don't know. But you know the Torah. It's not my business. We don't know. We don't care. Allah did not mention their names. How old he was exactly? We don't know. What is his order between his brothers? We don't know. But you know, we don't know. But okay, simply we don't care. How shall I know that I'm not supposed to care? Because Allah did not mention it. Look how simple it is. So, therefore, this is very important when you deal with the story. Because sometimes the mind might keep searching somewhere else. In a jalsat al-ilm, in the ilm sessions sometimes, you might go to some unnecessary details just to see what others who share us part of our history. Okay, to know how they think, what do they have. Sometimes we call it just for istiqnas, just to have an idea. Because, which could be part of why I'm saying that, because now I will be mentioning something from the Talmud in today's story, about the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. But we need to know. As long as Allah did not mention, there is no need. No need. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِي حَاجَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. What Allah says now in English,
Are you, O Prophet, not aware of the one who argued with Abraham about his Lord because Allah has granted him kingship? Did Allah mention who's he? No. Tabu'i? No need. Is it Namrud? Historically, the people, they say Namrud. But do we have crystal evidence that it is Namrud? No. I may mention it, it is believed for someone that is Namrud, but I don't use it as a base to build any kind of solid argument in it. Because simply, I don't know. It's something, because historically, not Islamically, according to the Old Testament, Ibrahim alayhi salam lived 19th century before Christ, which means about 4,000 years from now. Is it something for sure? No. The Old Testament says, claims that. We don't know. We have no idea. I'm not sure. But just have an idea. It is believed by someone. But I don't build basic concepts. Habil and Qabil, are they the names of the sons of Adam? We don't know. Quran called them, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ ابْنَيْ آدَمْ. Tell them, O Muhammad, the story of the two sons of Adam. What are the names? We don't know. Qabil and Habil, it's claimed in the Torah. Be careful. Okay? So it's good just to have a clear idea because it's not easy just to keep using. Now, Allah says, are you, O Prophet, not aware of the one who argued with Abraham about his Lord because Allah had granted him kingship? Remember, when Abraham said, my Lord is the one who has power to give life and cause death, he argued, I too have the power to give life and cause death. Abraham challenged him, Allah causes the sun to rise from the east, so make it rise from the west. And so this believer was dumbstruck, and Allah does not guide the wrongdoing people. And you know, because alhamdulillah, we are Muslims, we know the Quran, we know that the story of Ibrahim has not been mentioned just in this place. So we know a lot of other details. We will be mentioning some of them now. And I will use the tafsir of the meanings of Al-Bawdudi, Tafheem Al-Quran, to highlight something, because he mentioned something very important about Tawheed Al-Uluhiyya Wal-Rububiyya and this connection. And he quoted from the Talmud, because this is the only source that gives something close to the Quranic understanding of the story of the Quran. And when I say Talmud, by the way, Talmud is not the explanation of the Torah or the Old Testament or interpretation. When we have, for example, I need to just okay. Now, if I'm holding the book. Now, when I say Old Testament, imagine that this is the Old Testament. About 75% of the the Bible. Imagine that this is the Bible. Now, about 75% of the Bible is the Old Testament, which is OT, the abbreviation. The last quarter of this book is the New Testament, NT, okay? Old Testament contains hundreds, about 1,000, maybe 600 pages, 1,700 pages. The first five chapters, they are called the five chapters of Moses, i.e. the Torah. Just the first, less than 10%. Okay? The rest, after the five, up I think to 27, all of these, they are called the Book of Kings and the historical books. The Old Testament was called Old Testament by Christians, not by Jews. The Jews, they do not call it old. Okay? For them, they have the truth and that's it. They don't consider neither Christians nor Muslims. Christians, they considered the Old Testament their historical roots. So they brought the Old Testament, even though they had the New Testament. New Testament for Christians means the four Gospels. Gospel of Luke, Matthew, Mark, and John. And about 14 messages from St. Paul or Boros, okay? Saint Paul, who used to be Shaul or Saul. In Hebrew, he became a Christian, and he's considered for some many Christians as the real founder of Christianity. So four Gospels plus the messages of Paul and the divine dream of John. All of these is called New Testament, okay? So this is all called Bible. It was combined as the Bible by Christians, not by Jews. Now we have something called Talmud. Many people think that Talmud is the interpretation of the Torah, which is not. Now, according to Jews, Talmud used to be something similar to the Sunnah compared with the Quran for Muslims. Okay? Now, just to make it sure now, Jews believe that when Musa went to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah gave them al-alwah, the scriptures, okay? The tablets, which contains the guidance, contains the legislations. He received it literally written on tablets. Now they believe, I'm not commenting what do we believe because this is not the time now. I'm just telling them what they believe, okay? Problem of the internet. What I was saying. Okay, they believe that Musa alayhi salam received another guidance apart from the Ten Commandments and the Torah. It's an oral guidance. It was not written nor it was preserved in any form except memorization. Okay, this is the origin of the Talmud. This kind of oral transmitted guidance, it has interpretation, and it was just with the rabbis for hundreds of years. Now, later, after hundreds of years, after they were taken by the Babylonians in Iraq, they were taken from the kingdom of Israel, about after Suleiman and Dawood alayhi salam, they started putting it in a written form. It was called Talmud, okay? So as not to think that Talmud is, when I say, what do I mean by the word Talmud, in a very simple, short explanation. Type. Today, now, after I, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, I will be reading from Abu al-A'la al-Mawdudi, his direct in his book, translation, Tafheem al-Quran. And as long as we have the new faces as well, from the most well-known translations of the meaning of the Quran, basically, historically, the most well-known one was Abdullah Yusuf Ali, Tafsir al-Quran, Abdullah Yusuf Ali. It was the most famous for about maybe 20 or 30 years. Now, Abdullah Yusuf Ali, and there is Marmaduk Pekthel, translation of the meaning, and there is Khan and Al-Hilali, translation of the meaning, and there is now the new one, which I consider now one of the best, if not the best, is Mustafa Khattab translation, the clear Quran, and I advise you really to use it. But however, we have some others, everyone has. Now, Tafheem al-Quran is another translation by Abu al-A'la al-Mawdudi. Abu al-A'la al-Mawdudi, in his time, was one of the greatest scholar. If I'm not mistaken, he passed away in 1930. I forgot to lie. If someone can jump, please, Shihab. When Abu al-A'la al-Mawdudi was born, and is it 1930 something or 50 something? I forget. Anyway, Abu al-A'la al-Mawdudi has a book of Tafheem al-Quran. Now, 1979, he passed away. Ah, subhanAllah. I mixed in his mind between Abu al-A'la al-Mawdudi and Muhammad Rashid Rida. He passed in 1935. SubhanAllah. So just about 50 years he passed away. He was the greatest in his time in the subcontinent, what we know now as India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, which is Shibh al-Qarra al-Hindiya. In his book, Tafheem al-Quran, one of the unique things is his footnotes. Not just the direct. Now, the direct, I will read to you the direct. He says, Abu al-A'la al-Mawdudi, Did you not consider the case of the person who remonstrated with Abraham about who was Abraham's Lord, just because Allah has granted him dominion? When Abraham said, "My Lord is He who grants life and causes death," he replied, "I grant life and I cause death." Abraham said, "But surely Allah causes the sun to rise from the east. Now you cause it to rise from the west." Thereupon, the denier of the truth was confounded. Allah does not direct the wrongdoers to the right way. Now, Abu al-A'la Maududi has a unique way in the footnotes. He gives you a lot of beautiful explanation, which could be sometimes like a mini encyclopedia, in if you guess, because it's many volumes, okay? Look what he has, four footnotes. I will consider them my base in today's, his four footnotes about this ayah as a great scholar. Now I will be reading the first footnote. He said, "It was stated earlier that God is the protector and the supporter of the man of faith and brings him out of darkness." He's referring to the previous ayah. Allahu waliyyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. He is saying, it was stated earlier that God is the protector and the supporter of the man of faith and brings him out of darkness into light, whereas the protectors and supporters of the unbelievers are taghut. Do you remember? Do you remember what we said about the word taghut in the Quranic terminology? Anyone, any person, any group, anything that has been given the status of respect and worship and obedience other than Allah, all of them, they are called what? Taghut. Min dunillah. Anything. It could be a person. It could be a regime. It could be an idea. It could be a party. It could be a state. It could be a king. It could be, all of them, they are what? Taghut. As long as this thing, this man, person, whatever, was given the status of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of respect and obedience, which is solely should be just for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, whereas the protectors and supporters of the unbelievers are taghut, who lead him out of light into darkness. It is to illustrate that can you switch off this? Especially the one, yes. Bismillah. I hope. Yes. Disappeared. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inshallah. Hada. لا بدي أشوف وين الإشكالية، غير مكاني مثلاً يعني. أوكي. Hopefully. طيب. جزاكم الله خير. I think it's a little bit better. No. طيب. اللهم صل على سيدنا. It is to illustrate this that three examples are cited here. Sorry. Supporters. طاغوت. It is to illustrate this that three examples are cited here. The first is that of a person before whom truth was put with such clear and impressive arguments, and he could not refute it. But since he had placed his reins in the hands of Taghut, he still could not believe in it. The two subsequent examples are those of two people who clung to God as their support, and God drew them out of darkness so that they were enabled to perceive directly these realities, which are beyond the reach of man's perception. He continues in footnote 2. Here, the reference is to Nimrud. Now, he's using this narration from Talmud just to take it, because it's just as a history, not as a fact. That's why I give you this kind of, as a possible history, which goes in parallel with a lot of details in the Quran. He says, here, the reference is to the Nimrud, the ruler of the land of Abraham's birth, which is Iraq. The event which is referred to here is not mentioned at all in the Bible, which means the Old Testament. Let me see in the Bible because it's the Old Testament, definitely not the New Testament. However, the whole story occurs in the Talmud and is largely in harmony with the Quranic version. In the Talmudic version, it is said that the father of Abraham occupied the highest office in Nimrod's government. We don't have this detail. We know that there is a very tough argument between the father and the son. We know it. إِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ يَا أَبَتِي يَا أَبَتِي يَا أَبَتِي. We have a lot of verses about يَا أَبَتِي لَا تَعْبُدْ يَا أَبَتِي إِنِّي جَاءَنِي مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مَا لَمْ يَأْتِكَ. He was begging him. He was asking him. We know about that. Quran did that. And we can know from the context that his father has some kind of authority and status. But here in the Talmud, it is said literally that the father occupied the highest office in Nimrod's government, like the prime minister or the head of the office of the king. Subhanallah, look, if that's true, how difficult it is when you are in this status. Why Ibrahim alayhi salam has this, which we can relate to our time in many examples. Now, when Abraham denounced polytheism, are you aware with the word polytheism? What does it mean, all of you? Polytheism means shirk. Mono means one. Poly means many, which is Latin words. Monotheism, tawheed, or the oneness of Allah. Polytheism means many gods. Atheism means no God. Al-had. So we have no one, many. Okay? So this is all of them with ism. So Abraham denounced polytheism, preached the doctrine of the unity of God, and smashed the idols of the temple. And we know that because the Quran told us. قالوا من فعل هذا بآلهتنا قال أأنت فعلت هذا بآلهتنا يا إبراهيم قال بل فعله كبيرهم هذا فاسألوهم إن كانوا. When he smashed the idols, saying, who did this of our gods? Your gods? Said, okay, you know, look to the greatest of them, which means, hey, use your mind, think about what you are doing. This is your God. The same argument with the mushrikeen of Arabs. They used to build their gods from dates. When they are hungry, they eat their god. La ilaha illallah. Ya'mi God. You mean that? They said, you know, وَمَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. No, I don't worship it, but this is a little bit equal to God. طيب يا عمي, equal to God. This God is so weak to a degree that it's made out of dates, and when you are hungry, you eat it. After you eat it, where does your God go? Seriously, I'm asking. Because this is a Quranic methodology. Yes, then it goes where? Then. So God, where did God go?
Somewhere in the world.
Yes. You got my point? Which means, hey, use your mind. Think. What are you saying? You know, Arabs in the Jahiliyyah, they used to make it, subhanAllah. So he says, Abraham denounced polytheism, preached the doctrine of the unity of God, and smashed the idols of the temple. His own father lodged a complaint against him before the king. Look to the wala and bara. His own father complained against him. You know, democratic state in Iraq at that time. So he complained to the king against his son. You know, loyalty should be for the king. Wala wa وبراء طبعا طاعة ولي الأمر. It's you know, the same thing. Yeah. This was followed by the conversation which is mentioned here. Now conversation ألم ترى إلى الذي حاج إبراهيم. According to this understanding, this conversation ألم ترى إلى, have you not seen the one who argued with Ibrahim? Okay. أحيي وأميت. This happened after the story that we know it from the Quran, which he smashed the idols when they went to do something, their celebration in some of their religious events, and it happened what happened. Now, third footnote, which is the most important that I need now. He says, the dispute was over the question, whom did he acknowledge as his Lord? Dispute. Who's the Lord? Who is the Lord? لاحظ ألم تر إلى الذي حاج في ربه. Who's your Lord? Me or someone else? The same thing happened with أصحاب الأخدود. والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد. And according to the Mufassirin, this incident happened with Christians, genuine Christians, I mean Muslims, who followed Isa alayhi salam in their time, okay, before the change. So this, they were tested in some of the, we don't know the place, we don't know the exact time, we don't know the name, we don't care, okay? But it happened for genuine, true Muslim Christians or Christian Muslims, regardless, they were following the Sharia of Isa alayhi salam and the remaining of Sharia of Musa alayhi salam, they were Muslims in their time. They were tested by a king. وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَن يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. Their only reason for having this kind of hatred against them, just they believed in Allah. Believed, it's not a philosophy. Believed means they believe that Allah is their Lord and He is to be obeyed. This is the meaning, which means, no. Mr. King now has lost part of his authority. You got my point? Which means you believe, okay, but I'm not discussing with you. I'm just sitting alone. I believe, no, you have no right. What? Allah says clearly, وَمَا لَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَيُّؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ عَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. But I have not done anything for you. I will not allow you even to have this idea in your mind. What? By the way, this is an old-fashioned behavior by the dictator regimes. It's not something new. long time ago. So the dispute was over the question, whom I'm quoting now al-Maududi, whom did he acknowledge as his Lord? The reason why this dispute arose was that God had granted kingship to the remonstrator, namely Nimrud. شوف آتاه الله الملك. And be careful here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يؤتي, gives power, authority, health, wealth for a believer and unbeliever. Be careful. Because some people, they misunderstand the concept of rizq or tawfiq with in this dunya. They think that if Allah is satisfied from someone, He will give him this. No. Allah gives the dunya for mu'min and kafir. Atahu Allah al-mulk. He was claiming divinity and lordship, and Allah gave him. Fir'aun. Fir'aun was one of the greatest rulers in his time. Who gave him the power? يُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِنْ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah gives and Allah gives. So it's a test. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. In order to comprehend fully the nature of the dispute hinted at this statement, it is necessary to bear in mind the following. Look what he's explaining as a alim now. He said to understand the core point of the dispute. Who's your Lord? Who's your Lord? Is it me? Is it? Now Al-Maududi says, all, which is really very nice, and if you really comprehend what I will be reciting now from Al-Maududi, it will help you to comprehend and to summarize a lot of faith points in Islam. He says, number one, all polytheistic societies from the earliest times till today share one characteristic. They share, all polytheistic societies, they acknowledge God to be the Lord of the Lords, the greatest of all deities, al-Aliha. They are unwilling to acknowledge Him, however, as the only God and the only object of man's worship and service. This is very important, which is 100% applicable on the people of Mecca. All polytheistic societies, They don't have any problem with God's existence or even God's what? Lordship in terms of His creation. What is the proof for that? We said it maybe 100 times. وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ يَقُولُونَ الله. If you asked him who created heavens and earth, they would say الله. وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَسَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ لَيَقُولُونَ الله. The people of Mecca, Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Abu Umay, all of them, they believe in that. But where's the problem? They bring someone's else with Allah. If I fight, they destroy the whole idea by bringing someone else. Now, he continues. Two polytheists tended to divide Godhead into two categories. Now, he's analyzing the history of polytheism. They tend to categorize Godhead into the concept of uluhiyya, or dealing with this God who should be the only creator, should be the only thing to be worshipped, into two categories. One of these belongs to the supernatural stratum. Now, to the supernatural stratum, the being invested with Godhead at this stratum rules over the entire system of causation and is the one to whom man turns for the fulfillment of his needs and for solutions to his problems. Which means, brother, can you close the door, Marish? Because if the kids are playing, and I will lose my control. Jazakallah khair. Sorry for that. Which means, as long as we are talking about the universe, the creation, outside there, okay, no, we have no problem. He is the creator, I mean, okay, I admit it, no problem. He is the creator, okay, no, don't worry, yes, I admit. He is the Razzaq, yes, yes, he is the Razzaq, I have no problem. But where's the problem? Look, قال, because of his problems. With this Godhead, the polytheists associate spirits, angels, jinn, heavenly bodies, and several other beings. Angels, they claim that the angels are the daughter of Allah, and they worship the jinn. وَأَنَّهُ كَانَ رِجَالٌ مِنَ الْإِنْسِ يَعُوذُونَ بِرِجَالٍ مِنَ الْجِنِّ فَزَادُوهُمْ Rahaqa. And by the way, many people literally today, they worship the shaitan, literally, but under some other names. Just other names, but they worship the shaitan. A lot of satanic rituals we have now. Speak, oh, people of science, millions of people they worship, they have satanic beliefs and satanic, a lot of. So, angels, jinn, supernatural spirits, demons, whatever. You have many titles. All of them, they have the same level, like God. This is number one, beings. To them, they address their prayers. They regard them as the objects of their worship. It is at their altars that offerings, the sacrifices, are placed. The second category of Godhead belongs to the social and political stratum. Look, they divide. We speak about the supernatural things, about when you need something, you want to fulfill your feelings, spirituality, or these things, go this to this supernatural being. Ooh, nice. You are a very spiritual person. As long as you are not interfering in my business. Get my point? Is it? Sorry. Now, the second category of Godhead belongs to the social and political. Social and political, which includes what? Power, money, ruling, legislation, controlling. No. This God has no right to interfere. Regardless, ya ammi, believe in whatever God you want. We have no problem with you as long as you are not interfering. Now, being who has now and refers to the being who has the privilege of absolute sovereignty, the one who is entitled to make the rules of conduct for human life. The one who is entitled to make the rules, okay, in this life. They don't want no interference. You have no rights. This is now. قال the one who is entitled to unreserved obedience, to unreserved obedience, the one who has unlimited authority to command in worldly matters. Now, which is exactly what happened for many people. From the very well-known examples, secularism against Christianity in 18th century, the end of 17th century, beginning of 18th century, yes, which is the French Revolution and secularism, which means, let's call it secularism, detachment completely between religion and state, or religion and politics and state, which means no problem, go to the church, worship your God, do your spiritual rituals as long as you are not interfering in anything has to do with our what? Governance, power, money, tax, politics, manufacturing. You know, this, all of the things out of so this is not just something has to do with the, we know, oh, this secularism. No. All the time, this is what the people are doing since the very early times of the history when it comes to love. This is exactly what the people of Mecca were trying to argue with Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. When they said, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَبِدُونَ مَا أَعْبَدُونَ. Why this ayah was revealed or this surah? I don't worship what you do. Because they came to him and say, يَا مُحَمَّد. يعني, let's find a solution in the middle. Don't keep attacking us. We're going to attack you. You worship our gods a day and we worship your God a day. يعني 50-50. خلينا حلوين بقى. ما تيجوا نحب بعض. What? What? And by the way, even non-believing systems, do they accept another ideology to rule with them? يعني for example, British Empire, do they accept communism in Russia to have half-half? For example, if, for example, imperialistic or capitalism in the UK or in the US, do they accept communism to be part of the ruling system? They don't. Why? Why when it comes to the religious people, you know, mix and share and be nice and be good. You know, this is the peace. But why you don't you accept it in your ruling system? Even sometimes when we have two political parties in the same country and they're loyal to the same country, they kick out, when they have the power, they kick out other party which share them with a lot of values. They don't accept them. What about another ideology? Completely. The reference point is completely different. Why you tell the people of faith to do that? He continues, the one who is entitled to make the rules of conduct for a human life, the one who is entitled to unreserved obedience, the one who has unlimited authority to command the worldly in worldly matters. Polytheists of all ages have either wrested this godhead from God altogether, or they have had this godhead distributed in addition to God among many other, such as royal dynastics, religious divines, and the venerated personalities of society, whether they belong to the past or to their own times. Many royal families have laid claim to godhead of the second category, and in order to consolidate their claim, they have pretended to be the offspring of gods in the former scene. This is exactly what the 44 families of pharaohs who ruled Egypt for thousands of years did. They want to control the people. They don't deny God's existence, so they claim they are what? From the offspring of God. And the religious authorities that they created, they help them to convince the people that this is. And that's why, by the way, we face a problem with some secular liberal people, which sometimes I don't blame them. Why? Because this is what they used to witness or to read about. So they think Islam is doing the same, which is not the case. Subhanallah. So this happened for hundreds and thousands of years in different societies, especially in the West, when they decided just to finish this and to have their own new life of liberalism and secularism, when you as a Muslim comes, as if you are reminding them of going back to the medievals, which is not the case, because the nature of Islam is unlike anything else. So that's why, subhanAllah, when you speak, when you have the opportunity to understand, most likely anyone who's seeking the truth will accept it. Plus, it's clear. It's clear. And one of my biggest evidences for that, that one of the biggest mainstream media of attacking Islam, let's say core point, is women's rights. Islam is based on violence, spread by sword, and discriminate against women. This is the best, most, wherever you go. Truth, am I exaggerating, or this is the reality? Yet, 75% in statistics since more than 30 years, to the best of my knowledge, 75% who convert to Islam are women, females. Mobile common sense. If there is some kind of reality in this claim, the most category that should be hating getting into Islam should be what? Woman, and not any woman. Liberal, free speech societies, Western woman. But who's coming to Islam? 75% of revert in the West, they are women, which have the full freedom. This gives you an idea. It gives you an idea about the power of the truth. So there's an obstacle. This obstacle could be by mainstream media, could be by some bad Muslims who bad behaviors, which is the case in all other religions, not just Muslims, but 2 billion. It's very natural to see some few hundreds of thousands of bad Muslims, ignorant Muslims. All other religions, they have this. But, you know, the one who knows that I do not judge you, because we have in the history, we don't judge, generalize against, you know, generalization is a very bad, immoral thing. This is one of the evidences. If that's the case, how come those highly educated females with a free liberal societies, they become, it's not just they become Muslims. They go and wear the niqab. La ilaha illallah. I mean, have you witnessed what is the percentage of the white Westerners, females, when they convert, how they immediately go to the niqab? Not just the hijab, the niqab. Which is not fully agreed upon. The hijab, except the face and the hands, no dispute, it's ijma'. But the niqab, there's a very, very valid, strong dispute between the sahaba themselves, Aisha and Ibn Abbas and Ibn Mas'ud. Yet, many of them, when they become immediately to the niqab, this gives you an idea that she found something related to the fitrah, the inner nature, the innate from inside. She said, this is what I need. I feel more free and more secure when I'm covered. I will not allow any, I'm speaking on their behalf now, okay, in my understanding. As if she's saying, I will not allow anyone in the streets to look at me as a sexual object. I'm not. I'm a human being with a personality. Don't judge me according to my how short my skirt is. Judge me in what I say, what I have here and what I have here. Not what I have here. This is the message of hijab, or part of the wisdom of the hijab. By the way, maybe we don't understand it, but they understand it, because they are females. They know what men look, think, and how they look at them. So when they discover the reality of Islam, oh my God, la ilaha illallah, this is, please, I want it. Because she knows. She experienced completely the other side of the coin, and she knows exactly what we are talking about. SubhanAllah. I'm just giving you quick examples. I continue now. He said, now Nimrud's claim to Godhood belonged to this second category. He did not deny the existence of God, and he did not deny that he was the creator of the heavens and the earth, and that he alone governed the entire universe. Nimrud did not claim for himself that he held the reins of the entire realm of possession in his hands. He claimed rather that he was the absolute sovereign of Chaldea. Chaldea, which is Kaldan, Al-Kaldaniya, you know? Bilad Kaldan, which is Al-Kaldaniyun, Wal-Babiliyun, you know, Wal-Ashuriyun. These are the names of the people who ruled Iraq at a certain times. the Chaldea and its inhabitants, that in his realm this world was, his world was low, that there was no authority superior to his own to which he was answerable. Any Chaldean who did not either acknowledge him to be his lord or took anyone other than him to be so was a rebel and a traitor. This is exactly, I repeat, subhanAllah, from this ayah in this final, inshallah, in 2 minutes I'll finish. This is exactly the concept that we explained when we were highlighting Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, Tawheed al-Rubbiyya, when we were highlighting Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum. And as we say always, please, don't let some kind of social media, especially take care of your kids, because when I speak, mashallah, Baba, do you believe in Allah? Yes, alhamdulillah. But others, I believe in Allah as well. Oh, nice, alhamdulillah, we are the same. What? What do you mean by believing in Allah? But alhamdulillah, mashallah, I know many people, they believe that Allah is one. Hala, the problem is finished. No. Believing in Allah in general will not solve the problem. Believing that Allah does exist will not solve the problem. Believing Allah is the only creator will not solve the problem. The problem will be solved after these things. To believe that this God, Allah, is the only God to be worshipped. Worship means obedience. He's the absolute authority upon me to tell me what are the rules that I should be following. When I refuse this, the whole case is destroyed. And this is exactly what Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, and the people of Mecca refused. And by the way, Abu Jahl was so honest with himself when he refused to say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Because now we live with a lot of munafiqeen in our time. They don't care. They say they are ready to say whatever you want to say because they don't care. Okay? Abu Jahl really did care about what to say. He said, I will not say it because he understands exactly what does it mean. They say Ashhadu, I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, which means I have to submit my will to his will. It's not just to have this kind of nice, cool faith. Do you have a Muslim al-cool? Muslim al-cool, okay, we believe in Allah and we are all brothers. Brothers in what? But the others, they don't look at you as as a believer. I mean, it's not just your problem. Please ask them, ask the others. Do they look at you as a believer? You don't believe in their religion. Are you a believer for them? What's the answer? No, you are not a non-believer, which is common sense. I accept it. He considers me a non-believer because it's a matter of faith. But for us, it's not just philosophical faith. It has a practical, technical application on ground. That's why I used to explain to my students at university, I used to tell them, when I quote, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ يَقُولُونَ اللَّهُ وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَسَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ يَقُولُونَ اللَّهُ. If you ask him, I said, you understand the disobedient, which make them non-believers, when you look, for example, وَلَا تُكْرِهُ فَتَيَاتِكُمْ عَلَى الْبِغَاءِ إِنْ أَرَدْنَا تَحَصُّنًا. Don't force your slave girls on prostitution. Pause. Go back in the history. Prostitution through female slaves, it was one of the biggest source of income in industry and finance in the Arabic Peninsula and in the world. Not just Arabs. Romans, Greek, Persians, East, West, North, South, Black, White, all of them. It was big. Now, up to now, some countries, their main source of income is prostitution. So when Allah said, wala, stop it, in our simple words, stop the industry of prostitution. Say, no, money, habibi, money. Slavery, money. They kidnap, they attack, they do the battles, they kidnap the people at any time, they sell them. The industry, type. Riba. Interest. من الذين يأكلون سوري اللهم صل على محمد شو بداية الآية تبعت لا يقوم الذي كما يقول يتخبط الشيطان المس بدايتها جزاك الله خير إن الذين those who consume the riba they do not wake up unless as the one who was touched by the shaitan this kind of attack but their own controls authority governance system in controlling the people was based on riba control political social financial system control that's why you know for example why Islam is attacked now in our days why Islam is attacked because if Islam is to be applied porn industry will stop Alcohol, another industry, alcohol. Ya Habibi ala alcohol. It's not billions, it's trillions. Trillions. طب from logical point, liberal, human point of view, alcohol worldwide, does it cause more harm or more benefits? But everyone knows that. Reason number one for domestic violence is alcohol. One of the main reasons of car accidents, alcohol, other sexual harassment, doing car accidents, something type. From one aspect, it's what? Industry, economy, and control. Control how? When the people, they are the elites, they can do the job. And this is two examples. Prostitution, porno, riba, something. This is when they say, no. We accept him there in the heavens. Okay, he does exist. He created everything. But it's we who decide how to rule ourselves in our way. By this, they became non-believers. قولوا قولي هذا واستغفر الله لكم. جزاكم الله خير. بارك الله فيكم. See you next week, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.